Hey! I didn't know you were ready.
What are you doing?
Oh, sitting there.
This is awesome. No pressure, pal.
Yeah, you can slate those two.
This is Sylvester Stallone, and I ride with El Rey.
Here we go. We're set.
I'm talking one of my all-time favorite heroes. Thank you, Sly, for being on the El Rey Network's Director's Chair.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
I've known you for 18 years now, man.
It has. It's
been. And we've talked many times about your career over that period, and I still don't know the answers to a lot of these questions I'm going to ask, because we all approach it differently.
Right.
And the Director's Chair is about a director asking another director about the craft and asking them questions that they don't normally get, and especially because you're a star. And an actor usually will get those kind of questions. I think people forget your career as a storyteller, either as a writer or as a director.
Thank you.
I want to do a director's chair with you because no one really, I think, appreciates the fact that you craft the stories, you direct them, you act in them. Most actors who direct will take a smaller role, if a role. They're not getting punched in the hip the whole time. And having to be in a peak physical condition, what you do is superhuman. Your passion, your drive, your focus, your expertise in creating these myths, these modern myths that we're here to talk about today as either a writer or as a director. Rocky.
Rocky! You're gonna become a very dangerous fighter.
Rocky 2.
He wants to bury you.
Is that all you got?
He wants to humiliate you.
Rocky 3.
You call yourself a fighter? Prove it not!
I am a tiger.
Rocky IV.
Today, the Soviet Union has officially entered professional boxing.
I must break you.
Rocky Balboa.
It ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward.
Paradise Alley.
But times is tough.
You got him!
First Blood.
Rambo.
Why would you be carrying a knife like this?
I'll give you a war you won't believe.
Rambo.
This is what we do. Who we are. Live for nothing. Or die for something.
And the Expendables.
If the money's right, we don't care where the job is.
Are you crazy? Gonna kill me?
You're welcome.
Our early days sort of define us as storytellers. When did you first become interested in filmmaking? Was it acting first or writing first, one before the other?
Well, actually, it was painting first. I was actually extremely visual, and I started to draw and paint. And I wasn't exactly a savant, but it was the first form of expression. And I kind of, like, with the kind of painting, I was always interested in depth perspective, even though I didn't even know what it meant back then. And when I would go to films, a lot of the films I went to were kind of juvenile kid films or coming of age things, or Robinson Crusoe. And I was taken with legend and spectacle. And it had a profound effect on me.
Was there any important figure in your life that created, influenced your creativity?
I was very impressed with Kirk Douglas. Vikings really hit me.
Oh, Ragnar!
Steve Reeves,
I love Steve Reeves. Steve Reeves. I was looking for some sort of male role model.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, this guy comes up who's like physical perfection. Even to this day, he's considered the perfect body, look, everything. And again, the deeds he performed, coupled with the physicality, blew my mind.
Right.
And at that time, I physically was thin, but there I saw a path. I said, my God. And I literally left the theater, and I was 12 years old, and went to a junkyard, which was near the theater in Maryland, and started looking for car parts that resembled weights. So it'd be little wheel wells.
It's like a real Rocky moment, going to the scrapyard.
Hubcaps or the wheel rims, and you could put a stick through them. And from that day on, it was that direction of a kind of physicality that I didn't know it was going to manifest itself like it did years later, but it was like that was the path.
Yeah.
That was the path.
What's the thing that turned it and got you into thinking that was even a viable option?
There was an audition for Death of a Salesman.
Right.
Never even heard of it. And I just, for some reason, I was drawn into that room. And I read, you got the part of Biff? I mean, I still remember the dialogue to this day. And so then we did the stage production, and the director there was a Harvard graduate, also had was involved in theater, said, you know, you should do this professionally. And that was it.
That's it. Sometimes somebody just knighting you like that will send you off on
Really?
Track.
Yes, absolutely. So then I headed to University of Miami in the Ring Theater, and it just didn't happen. We're doing improvs, playing Hunchback of Notre Dame, this and that. And that was also where failure was a great impetus. It went, okay, crossroad. You're not getting any acting parts. You're not connecting with any of the professors there. They think you mumble, you're this, you're that. You're just not what they consider acting material. And that's when I started writing. And that was the beginning. I can't emphasize how important that was. Like, for example, if I had been very successful at University of Miami, I never would have written. If I never wrote, I'd never have done Rocky.
Breaking the ribs.
You're gonna keep lightning, and you're gonna crap thunder.
With the 15 rounds, how do you feel?
All right, all right.
What are you thinking about when that buzzer sounds for that lightning? What you think about when the 15th round, when you're coming out?
So you were inspired by these mythological tales of heroes.
Right.
There's a culture need for these types of myths and stories. And you crafted one of the finest examples with Rocky.
Thank you.
How did you get to Rocky?
I had written about four serious screenplays. Then I went into audition for Shardoff and Winkler. And on the way out, he goes, oh, well, thanks for coming by. And I said, well, you know, I write a little bit, too. And he goes, well, if you got anything, bring it back. He said, seriously? Yeah.
He opened the door.
At first, Rocky was already retired. He was not a boxer at all. It was literally the story of a broken-down loan shark collector and his pet shop girlfriend, and that's it. It was extremely urban. I was very influenced, kind of like my Mean Street kind of a thing. And I think I touched on something without being very aware of it. In other words, there wasn't like a plan. And it was just something to get my foot in the door, and it was extremely emotional to me because I felt those things.
Talk about your prime.
What about my prime, Nick? At least you have prime. I ain't had no prime, I ain't had nothing.
Then I thought, Jesus, where's the beef here? Where's the real symbolism?
Where's the myth?
The myth. And I thought, okay. And I've always loved the Cinderella type story, where you know the metamorphosis aspect, where everyone blossomed.
You're gonna become a very dangerous place.
Well, I thought, you know, what about a hero who trains and is in the peak of perfection, and everyone's going, you're gonna do it, champ. And he looks at me and goes, no, I'm not gonna do it. I'm gonna get murdered. I'm gonna get hammered. But my goal is quite different than your goal. My goal is being able to live with myself. If I can stand up and be a man.
That gives me chills. That moment is such a great moment. I heard that it was like you had one take to shoot it or something, because they cut schedule way down. Was that part of the script, always part of the story? I have to give the speech where I say to Adrian, I'm not going to win.
I'm telling you something, Robert. The truth is, the producer comes, he goes, Sly, we're pulling the plug. That's it. And literally, they pulled the plug. I said, oh, you can't. He goes, yeah, we can. We are. We don't need this scene. I go, this is the whole movie. This is not a scene. This is the heart. It's like the body dies without this scene. He goes, why? I said, all right. And I was so upset. They couldn't see it, literally. And the crew at that time, like, we want to go home. You know, they couldn't give a shit about me. They said, hell with him. And I'm literally screaming at the crew. I said, guys, believe me, trust me. One take, okay? One.
Nobody's ever gone the distance with Creed. And if I can go that distance, seeing that bell rings and I'm still standing. I'm gonna know for the first time in my life, see? That I weren't just another bum from the neighborhood.
All right, that's a wrap. Next day, producer comes out, Rob Schrader goes, Sly, that's the best scene in the movie.
How did you get Rocky made as an actor? Because You went to them with the script. How long did it take you to write the script for Rocky? Once you knew you were going to do Rocky, how did you
It was very quick. I'm a big believer when I write to not worry about the flawed aspect of it. I know that maybe 90% is worthless, but the idea that you have a beginning, middle, and an end is very important to me. So it 3 days I wrote it. Then, of course, I went back and rewrote it. And then they go, and then we'd like to cast...
Cast who?
Ryan O'Neal. He likes to box or Burt Reynolds. And at that time, there was kind of like Jimmy Kahn. There was a lot of guys out there that were pretty physical. I go, well, no, I don't know if you understood that. I'm writing it for me. They said, no, it's not possible. And then he said, well, I'll tell you what. It'll be a 25-day shoot. And under $1 million and so on and so forth.
They wanted to cast it bigger and you got the role. And so they lowered the budget.
They lowered the budget to nothing.
It was probably a blessing in disguise. It made it so gritty and real.
Yeah. It was. And the first scene we shot in the movie was the scene where I run up to the guy and I'm shaking the guy down. And I go, come on, you want to dance, you got to pay the band. You got to pay the man.
You want to dance, you got to pay the band. You want to ball, you got to pay the man. Hey.
And he goes, I ain't emotionally involved, Bob. And it was a loan shark thing, and the studio went, oh, it's okay. But I know they wanted to shoot for a week and say, sayonara. I mean,
right.
I had to go out there by train. They wouldn't even give me a plane ticket.
Rocky was nominated for 10 Academy Awards. It was the biggest film of 1976. It was the first sports film ever to win a Best Picture. Was this your master class, in a way on filmmaking, getting to do that movie? Because you did write it and you saw how it went from script to screen. You went through the whole process with John.
Yeah,
you had to be in the room.
That was a masterclass. And how to really interpret the grandeur of the film, like the music. Bill Conti came in and just killed it.
What was that like when you heard his music on the movie for the first time?
It took my breath away. It seemed like a Roman Colosseum. It seemed like very gladiatorial. It's though he was Rocky, you know what I mean? He wrote from inside of the character, the point where it was just epic. It really was.
So the iconic run up the steps at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, they've even named those the Rocky Steps.
Yeah, imagine.
How did that moment come about? When did you first think that up?
First, when I was about 12, I lived in Philadelphia, and I was always enamored with that place, because no one ever went there. It was just the most amazing thing at the end of Ben Franklin Parkway, and you go up there and you feel like you could see the whole world, you could see your whole life from there. And that's what the steps was, just something where here is this intellectual bastard, center of arts, this incredible structure, the architecture, and here's the guy in sweatsuit, holes in his knees, and sweaty. But the two worked, just that contrast that Rocky would seek out this place for kind of a physical and spiritual enlightenment.
Yeah, like the mountain he has to climb.
Exactly, the mountain he had to climb. See, I believe at the end of a film, if you can get the auditory, the sound going, the kinetic and the visual all working, and I've only been able to do it once or twice in my life, at the very end of Rocky, the music is blaring. He's won the fight. The girl's rushing through the crowd. So you have the visual, you have the kinetic, and then you have the sound. I love you, I love you. Boom. So all three things peaked at that moment. Literally, and I said, we got to use the freeze frame. I said, let's capture them at the peak of his life. It'll never get better. That was it.
Yeah.
And the next frame, reality sets in. It's like, like us. It's like what we go through. It can't get any better. You're right, it won't. There is always this battle between trying to have supreme confidence to lead the truth, but also this like insecurity here. I hope I can pull this off. You've just been pummeled. Your first directorial effort, and here you are in your second one on a make or break film.
Here we go. For sec.
So Rocky was your master class, but actually the first picture you directed was Paradise Alley.
I'm not treating
you crummy.
Yeah, you are.
I treat you crummy.
What do you got against making an honest buck?
Yep. Just depends how it's made.
Paradise Alley was about three brothers and how greed separates them, how they fall apart and then come together. But Paradise Alley was this place that, God, I wish it existed. I always looked at it as kind of like this metaphoric place where everyone, you wish you could go. And when you went down there, there was hope and opportunity and escapism from your doldrum life. When I got an opportunity to direct that, I said, okay, this is gonna be interesting. It was big, it was ensemble, it was period piece, so you're dealing with a lot of, it was being in the trenches. It wasn't a simple film, it was a complicated film, but then again, it also dealt with fighting.
No rules will prevail!
But it was wrestling. I said, you gotta make this somewhat balletic. That's why I went, it was raining inside the building.
That was beautiful, that was a great sequence.
It was kind of interesting.
Way to go with that. I mean, you couldn't have made Rocky 2 or 3 or 4 without the experience of doing Paradise Alley. What did you think you learned the most from doing that?
There is always this kind of battle between trying to have supreme confidence to lead the truth, but also this like insecurity here. I hope I can pull this off. You know, if I keep moving my feet fast enough, people won't see my shoes ain't shine. You know, just keep going. But I was directing Rocky 2 when Paradise Alley came out. So during my lunch break, I go to the premiere, the opening day of Paradise Alley. Four people in the audience. Now I have to leave that and go direct Rocky 2, which is following an Oscar-winning movie, and a director won an Oscar. It's like, oh my God. So that was another crossroad moment. You go, okay, you've just been pummeled.
Right.
Pummeled on your first directorial effort, and here you are in your second one on a make or break film.
Right.
Whoa.
And a blessing at the same time, because it's not in the can. There's still something you can do about it.
That's right.
You know, you're like, I'm going to ensure that this thing.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to try even harder now.
Tell me about Rocky 2.
What do you think you're doing for like the next 40 or 50 years?
Where is Rocky Balboa?
I know a lot of people out there want to see me in a rematch with the Italian Stallion.
There's one thing I want you to do for me. Win.
What are we waiting for?
I severely tore my chest in training, so they wanted to operate, and the injury was pretty bad. It was the whole pec had been torn up.
We'll fix that all right.
So I couldn't undergo an operation and do the movie at the same time, because it was almost a 6-month heal. So I said, okay, Rocky switches.
Just switch now to Southpaw anyway, will you?
No tricks, say switching.
That's like the most amazing story point, and that's the strangest reason that you did that.
That's right.
That's like a gift.
Well, you said taking a disaster and turning it into a positive.
You told me that a long time ago because I asked you questions, but I didn't believe it.
No!
Rocky films probably are what spurred the whole fitness fad of the 80s. And those training montages are iconic and just became part of the film language. Rocky 2's got two great ones that build with music. They're almost like musical arrangements. The image and sound, the slaps and the grunts. Rocky's body is like an instrument being played with the music.
There's certain staples, like the heavy bag, the speed bag, and jumping the rope. Then I would go to old school, and they would chase chickens, and they would carrying
the log on your back.
Which is exactly what Rocky and Marciano used to do. It's called the duck walk, which would build these powerful thighs.
And that speed bag finish of the montage. How were they conceived, and how much thought was put into the actions, and that they would play with the music, or was that happy accidents?
I said, Jesus, I can't cut between all this stuff, and the running, it's just not a flow at all. It's too jumpy. And I want to really service the running. And I want him to become a Pied Piper. So I said, we need two montages.
That's something you separate.
And I said, what's the break? Oh, he goes in, he kisses his
baby.
And that's just enough to people go, oh, okay, that's a breather.
And then back in.
Bam, bam, and he comes over, he vaults over the railing. And it's also an excellent time for the composer to cut loose.
Yeah.
We put in some temp music. And then he took that temp music and made something wholly unique and special that still gets my blood going today. His shin hits me here. That's a high jump. Like, whoom.
Rocky IV, did you get knocked into the hospital?
Oh, my God.
Here we go. For sec.
Performer versus filmmaker. I mean, as a performer, you've always been sort of categorized with other, you know, like Arnold and Bruce. But as an artist and as a creator, you're in a completely different league, even in a different league from other directors, because of this relentless on-screen presence and having to stay in this sort of insane shape while you're doing it, like we do when we get into Rocky III.
Philadelphia salutes its favorite son, Rocky Balboa.
I pity the fool.
You're not getting it tomorrow, Rocky.
I will destroy any man who tries to take what I got.
What's the matter with you? Big
bust you up.
Go for it.
I really wanted to go where no one had gone before with Eye of the Tiger. And Bill Conti didn't want to go there.
Oh, that's the best song. And that's what's so brave about what you did, is that you broke from the formula.
I was sort of going against the tide because there was a stigma attached to, quote, a sequel. Back then, it was an anathema.
There's never been a part three of anything.
I just didn't understand why you couldn't see the continuing metamorphosis and growth. We could literally make a movie about who we are every 3 years because we're changing. And I thought, you know, that's an interesting thing. I'm going to have the vanity come through. He's now commercialized, well-dressed. He drives a Maserati. He goes, that's not Rocky.
And he gets his ass kicked.
He's going to get his ass kicked, this guy.
The worst thing happened to you, you got civilized.
I looked at my body and went, okay, Rocky now has become incredibly vain. So I'm going to train in such a way where you break down all the body fat. I went down to about like 155 pounds, living pretty much on fish and water. I was getting mercury poisoning. And just to keep going, I was drinking, and I'm not joking, 25, 30 cups of coffee a day.
Go out there and do it, Rob.
You're so bad. I have a tiger.
How do you direct when you're getting punched in the head?
Oh,
the crew's going, Sly, where do you want the camera next? Are you like Jell-O at that point?
Yeah, Mr. T beating on you. That made it difficult to keep track of all the shots. For example, I'm running 9 cameras, and you have to keep running around. Back then, we didn't have all those monitors. You had to go up to the top of the bleachers, come back down. Let's change that. Let's go to 35. And you go, well, did I say 35? Yeah, okay. And you're just trying to keep track of all this stuff in your boxing shorts with blood on your face. You go, okay.
Oh, yeah, and these guys are really going to pull their punches.
I'll tell you, the worst physical beating I ever got was Hulk Hogan in his prime. He's only about 320 pounds, massive human being with 23-inch arms. And this guy hit me once. I'm in the corner. He comes in, whoa. And his shin hits me here. That's a high jump. It came down, and I swear to you, I hit the canvas, and I didn't want to look over because I knew, I said, my bone has to be protruding. I know he shattered my collarbone. I know it. I was done for a few hours.
Hey, why'd you get so crazy on me out there?
That's the name of the game.
And then you got to rehearse with these guys.
roll on the rehearsal.
And then, you know, people going, hey, okay, we're going to keep filming. I go, yeah, we got to keep going. So there's Robert, it's when a director has a vision, I think something clicks in that is supernatural, and you just push all that pain or all that distraction away, and you become obsessed. And you're in the middle of the night, you're waking up with writing lines and things. And then the day you rap, I literally go.
No, you get sick at the end. And everyone else was sick on the crew and you weren't. You're like, oh, I guess I didn't catch it. You had it, but your body didn't let you have it.
So you had that too?
I've had that before, but that's a very minor degree. I'm not doing
it. No, but.
I mean, it's so physically and mentally draining to direct. So I can't imagine at the level that you're doing in there, in front, getting smacked, hit, and having to be. How do you even schedule that? Do you schedule like devastation day so that you know, all right, you're gonna kill me for 5 days and then I'll take a break? Or was it all over the map in those days?
No. You have to be aware of.
So you were able to schedule like the fights early, maybe.
Yeah, early. First thing,
fights.
I said, let's get these out of the way. That way, if the fights, there's something deficient in the fights, that you still have another 8 weeks, 7 weeks to fix them. In Rocky, the first one, the fights were the last thing, and you couldn't go back and fix it. And we had to. It just didn't have the proper ending. So literally, you had to ask a few friends. We had about 20 extras. They only dressed a corner of the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Not even the whole ring. The thing was just wood.
Watching the Rockies one after another, you really see how relevant you kept the character and the story through the times. I mean, Rocky is definitely, you know, like a mid-70s movie. Rocky II, late 70s. Rocky III, heralding, you know, the new decade. Rocky IV. I mean, you really moved the character through and keep him relevant for young people and kept the story fresh by somehow stripping him back down into being an underdog.
It's physically impossible for this little man to win. Whatever Drago hits, he destroys.
Oh, it's suicide! You can't win!
If he dies, he dies.
But if I can change, and if you can change, everybody can change!
The Rocky Fourth, I went, I'm gonna try to do something. Now, at this point, he's having the burden of carrying a country on his back, which means, you know, all of a sudden you play country against country, there's so much pressure, like the Ryder Cup, or any time it's, you know, the World Cup in soccer, it takes on such significance as opposed to clubs within this, you know, it's just fighting another American, now you're fighting a Russian. So I borrowed that motif from Joe Louis when he had to fight Max Schmeling in the 30s, and that was, that had nothing to do with these fighters. It was about Hitler and about this and Franklin Roosevelt. It was a big deal. One of the most seminal fights of all time.
Rocky IV, did you get knocked into the hospital by Dolph?
I had gone, first of all, Dolph Lundgren is a specimen. He's a world champion kickboxer, and he could hit, really hit. Because I saw him and Carl, you know, get into it. So powerful. I had gone to Vegas, and in the name of realism, I saw Hagler and Hearns go at it.
There's blood all over Marvin Hagler's face. Can't tell where it's coming from.
The fight was over in 2.5 rounds, and it was the bloodiest, brutal thing. So I said, Dolph, you know, I got an idea. I want you just to unload on me for about 20 seconds. Just try to knock me out. I kind of know what you're going to do, but just go for it, and then we'll go to our choreography. I'll push you away, and then when I slip out of the corner, that means we're back on track. Don't keep unloading him.
I must break you.
Because he's so big. So he's moving around, and he comes across the ring, like a building. Boom, boom, and I mean, he's cranking with this huge frame, and I'm feeling like my insides collapse. Yeah. My kidneys, I couldn't yell good. Boom. Next thing I know, I'm in intensive care for 4 days because he had hit me in the heart so hard that the pericardial sac that surrounds the heart fills up with water. And he goes, we usually see this in a head-on collision in a car with a steering wheel hit you. Close. I got hit by a truck.
You didn't direct this one, but let's talk about First Blood. 21 years went by before you directed again. You know, unbelievable to think.
Was it really?
It was 21 years after Rocky IV.
Here we go, for set.
And action.
You didn't direct this one, but you really created this character and shaped it with your rewrite and your performance. Let's talk about First Blood.
You don't seem to want to accept the fact that you're dealing with an expert in guerrilla warfare. Best with guns, with knives, with his bare hands. A man who's been trained to ignore pain, to live off the land. I didn't come here to rescue Rambo from you. I came here to rescue you from him.
It was the 11th choice for that player part. It had been around
for years and years.
For years and years and years. And they presented it to me. He said, what do you think? I go, wow, this is different. This is almost a Frankenstein story. You create this monster, comes back, and now everyone wants to destroy it. But we have to just throw out everything and start from scratch. No, we paid money for this dialogue. I go, well, this dialogue is, everyone should talk about him, but he shouldn't talk about himself.
Right.
There would be lines in there like, where do you think you're going? He goes, I'm going up to Portland. Did you ever hear of Easy Rider? Probably then he'd go, no. He goes, well, I'm Easy Walker. And I'm walking. I go, cut, time.
Yeah, okay.
you can't.
Where are you going? North.
North.
Headed north or south?
North.
Did you know somebody like, or you just saw it and you go, I know what this story needs? Because you made a myth out of that.
There wasn't a real prototype. I felt that this character is someone who really speaks physically with his body. He, in everything, his looks, and he's almost cat-like. And there's kind of physicality to it. I mean, that water, today you'd build a set, you know. But when you're in a cave, you're in a cave, and it's freezing. And those rats, when they hit that water, they say, oh, they're lab rats. Not when they hit that water, they're like rat rats. Wow. they're going for the first thing warm. The way that was filmed with Andy Laszlo, I thought he did an incredible job.
Shot
for example, all that stuff in the tunnel, that's torchlight. There is
no extra.
Yeah, no.
So 21 years went by before you directed again. That was unbelievable to think.
Was it really?
It was 21 years after Rocky IV. I'd like to think that I was a bit of an influence on your going back to directing, because when I worked with you in 2003, we were talking about the films that hadn't been working for you, and I said, man, you got to go back to directing. You were so good at directing yourself. And I don't see how you could ever accept someone else truly taking over the reins when they're not going to be at the same level you were in your peak performances in the movies that did the best for you.
It's true.
And 3 years later, you started a run. I mean, just came out swinging. So I want to treat this as its own section, because it really is a restart of your career.
Yeah.
As a filmmaker, Rocky Balboa, Rambo, Expendables, like three punches in a row.
Yeah, I was so sorry I didn't do well on Rocky V or direct it or something. I just felt I had really neglected. If one thing, if I want to end my career, I wanted to at least salvage that. I didn't want to end in a sour note. So I kept pushing and pushing and pushing Rocky Balboa, and they said, looks like, come on, you know, it's never going to work. It's been 15 years. Rocky V didn't work. So it was by far 10 times harder than Rocky I.
To get made.
Yeah,
right.
It's a skepticism. There's no element of surprise. It's a different business. They basically said, over our dead bodies are we going to make this.
Wow.
But, you know, well, there was a regime change, and okay, we'll give it a shot. But you direct, I said, yeah, of course I want to direct it, because this time I had a vision.
Sometimes it's hard to breathe. You know, I feel like this beast inside me. You know, the older I get, the more things I gotta leave behind. That's life. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done.
I really was happy with the way it turned out, because to me it's really tragic. You know, it says I always wanted to take the first one and it ends in the ring. Dun, 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 dun. They're in love. It's the high point. Dissolve to the last one. Now he's sitting in front of a grave on a chair. That's what life does. That's the journey. 40 years later, you didn't see that coming.
I just never knew it was supposed to be this hard. It wasn't supposed to be like this, Paul, you know?
With Rocky, I tried to just keep it emotionally real and simple.
And this is shows why it's so important when you have a vision that you should have directed yourself. I remember when you first told me that you had this plan to shoot the fight in HD like it's a pay-per-view.
Mason, the line, Dixon, and Rocky, the Italian stallion, Balboa.
I remember thinking, how's that gonna work? I mean, it's hyper real. And you're staging, I was thinking about the old Rockies, where it was not about realism, it was about the fight being dramatic. That's all that counted. But I thought, how is he gonna sell the fighting if it's hyper real like that? And your answer was bone-crushingly simple, hit for real. Y'all kicked each other's ass for real, and it worked so well.
Since this is in high def, and I want to be able to put the camera profile, 99.9% of all boxing matches is always over his shoulder, as you know, it's depth perspective. You can miss by 3 feet. But you turn sideways as we're throwing, and you actually see the contact, you can freeze frame it, and you go, okay, I get it.
When you've been in the game as long as this, you know, there's certain full circles that happen. Yeah. What was that like on the, I can't even imagine, you know, when these things happen in your career, where you're running up the steps the last day of the shoot of Rocky Balboa?
That was a rough one. It was also, you know, it's heaven and hell. It's beautiful. But you're saying goodbye to your best friend, sort of man that you've made everything possible. I used the last frame in the credit where he's just standing there looking out of the city. That was actually me reflecting on, this is, his journey's over. It's so sad. But then again, Rocky saved my life again. You know what I mean? It's right. Like this is what brought me in, and this is what kind of resuscitated me. It's just this amazing, wonderful character, you know?
And you got to complete that journey.
Yeah. I had to shock him, but it wasn't like a punch. It was, yeah. To see me as a lone wolf again, we've seen that. I thought, why don't I do that with some of these action guys?
Here we go, for set. Here we go, for set. And action.
Rambo.
Yeah.
Where there is hatred, let me bring love. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light.
Quentin said famously at the time, if it was a newcomer who directed this movie, he'd be the toast of the town. Because it was Stallone. Everyone takes it for granted. But it's an amazing film.
Every Rambo had at least 1 foot in something that actually had occurred in history. So you have post-traumatic stress syndrome, the first one. The second one was going back to Vietnam. And then last one, I did research going, what is the worst place that no one knows about? And Burma. Then there's a big religious aspect to it because you have a lot of these Christians coming over there that think they're going to change everything with no guns. Then you have Rambo who's become part of the landscape, a beast.
Truly a beast.
Truly
the way
a beast.
You play him, scary.
I told my wife, I said, I'm going to morph into something. So I put on about 30 pounds and I got I thought he's become an ape. He's just, and then in comes this girl and she sparks this sense of just a little bit of humanity there.
Barely.
And it's almost like the, you know, King Kong, and he sees this girl, and it's like the, and I said, this is really interesting. This is almost like a fable. And to protect her, he goes into hell.
One of my favorite sequences is the one on the boat when you're first riding by the Burmese pirates.
Right.
And it's so freaking intense, because we all know Rambo, and you can tell the other characters don't. And when we see you with the eyes.
Burmese pirates. Tell everyone to stay down, don't make a sound.
We know they're up shit creek.
Yeah.
And it's so freaking intense.
Sit down!
Keep your head down and nobody look him in the eye, they'll kill you.
And when you clock everybody on the boat, you realize it's going down and you have to take out everyone and become what you've been trying to hide from.
That scene. It took, I said, I just have to, you're gonna see a side of Rambo, and he goes, you're gonna see how he's been holding back all these years. And I thought in the other ones, perhaps he was a little too, conscious of being a hero.
Right.
This one.
It wasn't polite anymore.
No, no.
We came here to help stop the killing. Who are you to turn that on?
Who are you?
Let him go.
And you told me that you, just physically, you got the guy on the breastbone.
I had to shock him, but it wasn't like a punch. It was
yeah, it's right here.
And I knew I just had to, it had to be one. You couldn't go cut.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It just had to be, oh my God.
Yeah, you go, oh
my
God.
He really put his hands on his dude and against the pole. And when doing that, now as a director, I go, okay, I got the shot. In other words, I'm thinking while you're acting, now you got to deliver it.
He would have raped her 50 times and cut your fucking heads off.
You see, the actor's like a little freak. Ignore him. I keep going.
Who are you? Who are any of you?
And I go, oh my God, this thing will play in this shot. Thank God.
Rocky's very much a loner. Rambo's definitely a loner. But now you came in with this mythology of this, you know, group. Called The Expendables.
What's that?
In a text.
Excuse me?
I was thinking about all these, you know, great war films, buddy films, and to see me as a lone wolf again, we've seen that, and the age factor plays into it. I thought, let me think about, well, when I go to see a old rock and roll concert, a revival, you don't see one group. They bring about 15 groups, you know, all one-hit wonders or something like that, and they put it together and go, oh, okay, this is an evening. If this one stinks, this one's coming up. Where do you hear this one? Where do you hear this character? And that becomes an event. But you wouldn't go to see that one old group. You go, oh, I don't know. Maybe you would, maybe you wouldn't. But it wouldn't be a big audience. It would be a very narrow audience. I thought, why don't I do that with some of these action guys that have been working? You put them together, that becomes an event.
You are so close to a movie.
Be a single on me and Randy, OK?
As a director, as a writer, you're always going to be close. But when you're also in it, and you're also the star, and you're also the franchise, I mean, how do you get any objectivity? Do you just go with gut?
I think I try to work out, I know, all the kind of like trust issues before we start filming. Once we're rolling, it's on autopilot. It's a go, because I don't have time to mess around.
We should work on the choreography here.
In the documentary on the making of Expendables, when you're trying to act and direct and ad-lib and keep track and no, go back, and stay in character.
Say, drop your gun.
Drop your guns!
Pause,
drop
pause.
Your guns.
Pause, right there. Now, we react on each one of us on drop our guns, right?
It's the hard part sometimes of being in the moment. You're like talking to yourself, you're directing yourself, directing him.
Say, drop our guns, Jason, you go like.
Drop your guns!
And you're trying to stay at this frenzy level.
Kill her!
Okay, cut.
it's really fun when you do it. Yeah.
As soon as he goes back,
directing from within the film, you know, it's kind of a different outlook on the end product. You know, I look at so many directors, many that you interview, like Bob Zemeckis and of course Quentin, and I'm like, wow, this guy's really, really good. And what do you bring to the table? And I try to bring, I said, a kind of intensity. I like setting a pace that's a little aggressive.
I can do this better.
I throw everything into it and become very, very protective of it and committed to it. Everything I approach it like it will be the last one. You have a gun and maybe there's three bullets left. World's moving on. Time is flying. You just got to throw yourself in with reckless abandon. I think you got to feel a little nuts. And be a little crazy. And I use that philosophy that James J. Corbett used. He says, when you're sitting in the corner in the ring and your nose is broken and your jaw hurts and your teeth are loose and you're begging for the other guy to hit you on the chin and knock you out.
Don't get up. Just stay down there. Stay down there.
There's a part of you that says, man, I'm going to go one more round.
You're the first cinematic hero in my life, and you continue to be an inspiration today. This is Sylvester Stallone, an icon, a legend, a very talented storyteller and director. We're privileged to have him here on the El Rey Network and the director's chair. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, brother. Thank you.